Lecture 10, The Doctrine of Angels. So this is actually part of an entire new section. The first part of our discussion introduced theology and then the doctrine of God. We talked about attributes and then specific attributes, the attributes of greatness, the attributes of goodness, as well as the works of God and the problem of evil. That as a unit then is our discussion of kind of the foundation of theology. What is theology? How do we do it? And who is God? But we're moving now into the doctrine of creation. This is a very natural fit with the works of God. God has done something, and that begins with the story of creation itself, which we will discuss in three divisions: the doctrine of angels, the doctrine of man, and then the world itself. Those three as subsets under the doctrine of creation. God created, and here are three things that he made. Under the doctrine of angels, we will actually have two lectures just because of time. And we'll start out this time with a discussion of angels and angels in general. In other words, we will talk about what is an angel, what are the nature of angels. And then in the future, or a subsequent lecture, we will talk specifically about Satan and the demons as a subset of the angels. But I'll just start out with this as a kind of introduction. It is often fantasized and made fantastical. The imagination runs wild around angels and what they're like. Here is a famous painting, Peter Bruegel the Elder. It's the Fall of the Rebel Angels, based off of Revelation 12. It's a 16th century painting. And you can just see the rebel angels are all manner of different creatures, all of them rather disgusting, reptilian type creatures, monsters. And these, I think, are supposed to represent both demonic angels, but also then you see something like more like creatures among the demons. And the good angels are more anthropomorphic. Some of them are dressed as medieval knights. They're using medieval era swords, and they're going to be dressed, many of them, in white or flowing type garments, but in any case, basically human-like in form, with wings, using swords, human-like faces, and shining, bright kind of creatures. So does this accurately represent what Scripture tells us about angels? Is there something more that we can say, or should we say less, or where do we even begin with thinking about the doctrine of angels? And my proposal for our time is to work through the following set of questions. These are, I think, relatively typical or representative questions that people might wonder about with angels. First of all, are angels eternal? I don't mean everlasting, as in the same sense that I am everlasting. The biblical teaching is that I will never cease to exist. I will endure, or I will exist forever. But I had a beginning. So I'm not eternal in the sense that I've always been, just that I will never cease to exist. And a technical way to refer to that is everlasting. Are angels eternal? Have they existed forever? Second, are angels omniscient, omnipresent, or omnipotent? Can Satan know everything? Can Satan know what I'm thinking right now if I don't say it? How are angels different from humans? How many angels are there, after all? And finally, what do angels do? Other questions that we could fit in here as kind of sub-questions or related questions are just kind of the imagination. What, if we imagine an angel, what would an angel look like? And what is their nature? What is their appearance? Should we be giving paintings like Peter Bruegel's painting and kind of creating an anthropomorphic form, a human-like form with angels? And how do we think about them in general? But I'm going to ask you a question for starters that I think will introduce quite a few of the concepts that I want to get to. And the question goes like this: when we talk about angels, should we imagine that angels are more like humans or more like God? Let me give you a diagram that you'll be familiar with already. I've done something with you before that was somewhat similar to this diagram, or at least related to the diagram. But here, we'll just give a bit of a difference as far as the diagram goes. We're comparing here God and humans. So, okay, recognizing then God and humans and the massive distance between the two. God is so much greater than we are, or to use Isaiah's language, his ways are not like our ways. His ways are higher, immensely higher than our ways. My question then is, where do angels fit in that kind of framework? Should I place angels, well, you know, they're in the presence of God, aren't they? And so I find their proximity to God right around the throne described in Isaiah 6 or Revelation 4 and 5 or Ezekiel 1 and 10. Angels very proximate to God. Are angels more like him? God, after all, is a spiritual being. Angels are spiritual beings. God has no sin. They have no sin. They see him directly face to face. So in all of those ways, you could be tempted to put them there. Would you want to put angels here? And, you know, if you, let's say, are particularly, you're particularly attracted by the anthropomorphic kind of representation we saw in the previous painting, maybe we would imagine something like that. They're rather human-like. And so as such, then maybe we put them closer to humans. Or do we put them somewhere like right in the middle? They're spiritual beings, and so therefore closer to God, and they're yet at the same time limited, and so they're closer to us. Or where do we place them? Okay, and I'll think about that for a moment. Often, I think the answer I hear is something like this. We're going to place them in the middle. Here would be my suggestion, but I'm fairly confident of it, that when we talk about angels, really where we ought to be placing them is right down here to go together with the humans. And I would place it something like this. And what will help give you a clue about my argument is just recognizing this part of the diagram if I draw a line across the middle. Because immediately that places into a diagram that we have worked with in the past. And my diagram went, The entire way that you ought to structure or understand the universe is in two categories, the two categories that summarize everything, God and everything else. And the line that stretches between them is to say there is absolute sharp distinction between God and everything else because nothing else is like him. How so? One of the core categories we talked about with that is that God is creator, everything else is created. And once we recognize it like that, then we realize he is the only creator. He is the only one that existed eternally. He is the only one that has no beginning. Everything else is created by God and dependent on his power to exist. The rest of everything depends on God. And when I put it in that category, then I recognize, and within the rest of that framework, I recognize that angels really are just part of the everything else. They belong down here together with the humans. Angels are just part of this entire category. So that I want to place them here together with created things to affirm absolutely and clearly without any question that angels are simply things that God made. Now, that foundation is going to help us immensely as we get started thinking about the nature of angels, because it helps us recognize just with this framework, then they have a beginning, they're created by God, their existence is supported by the power of God, and therefore, just like we, they worship, they serve, they must obey, they are limited in all of these ways. Actually, they are quite parallel to us. And absolutely no, there is no legitimate comparison you would want to make between angels and God. Let me support that with a little bit of scripture. So let's look at Hebrews chapter 1. First, I would like to demonstrate that angels are the topic of the chapter. So you have a comparison here between Jesus and the angels. Jesus is so much better than the angels. To which angel would the Father ever say, "You are my son"? Absolutely not. Let all the angels of God worship him. Angels worship God. They are not in any way semi-divine or something like that. Of the angels, he says, who makes his angels spirits and his ministers a flame of fire? I would like to just point out here, it's he makes his angels spirits. He creates his angels. And again, verse 14, are they not all ministering spirits sent forth to minister? Angels are created beings made by God for his purposes. So we'll start out with that as the first answer to our question. The question we asked was, are angels eternal? Do angels have a beginning? Or are they like God, where they've existed forever? And the absolute and clear answer you must give here is that angels are created beings. Angels are one more category of creation. What I would like you to think of when you think of angels is just to look across the creation and think of the different categories of things God has made. God made plants, God made animals, God made people, God made the physical inanimate creation like stars and rocks and volcanoes, and God made angels. It's another category. And it's as simple then as placing angels into one more category among all the other things that God has made. Perhaps because we can't see angels, we somehow grant them a different category, but we shouldn't. It's much simpler than that. Angels are just another thing that God made. The second question we started out with was the nature or the limitations of angels. Are angels omniscient? Are they omnipresent? Are they omnipotent? And there are multiple passages here, we'll just look at three, that will demonstrate, no, angels are limited just like we are. One of those passages is the passage we just looked at, Hebrews 1:14. On the question of omnipresent, well, just notice, angels are sent forth to minister. And that may not be an immediate obvious argument, but I think the argument would go, if angels were omnipresent, if angels could be anywhere, why would they need to be sent? No, they're not everywhere as in the way God is everywhere. They can move, they can travel, they can be sent, but they are not everywhere. In the same way, Daniel 10:13, this is a very interesting passage that we'll do our best to come back to. The prince of the kingdom of Persia withstood me for 21 days, but Michael, one of the chief princes, came to help me. And I remained there with the kings of Persia. Now, what's going on in this passage? The basic idea is spiritual warfare. The angels are fighting with demons, and there's a battle between them, and there's even actually some limitations. He withstood me for 21 days. I fought him, and I couldn't overcome for 21 days. But the point that I'm making in this particular connection regarding omnipresence is to say that, no, this angel is limited, Gabriel, is at this moment limited in his ability to travel because a demon is stopping him. And Michael later comes to join him in the battle, and he remained there, he says, with the kings of Persia in the battle, part of this spiritual warfare, whatever else is going on. And the point is, there's a limitation of space. If the angel is here, he is not there, or there, he's here. What about the question of omniscience? Do they know everything? Well, here we have a second set of passages that work like this. He talks about things that were revealed. He talks about the gospel, 1 Peter 1:12, and that this gospel has been revealed. But then the comment, these are things into which angels desire to look. And I think the striking thing about that statement is the notion that angels are curious about some stuff. Angels are shocked or amazed or wondering if they could learn more about certain things. So angels are absolutely limited in their knowledge in the sense that there are things they don't know, even things that they would love to learn more about. And we'll see later today that angels can be surprised or astounded. And finally, on the question of omnipotence, are angels all powerful like God? Well, I would just like us to notice Jude 9. This is Michael the archangel, and so probably, arguably, he is the greatest of the angels. We'll return to that concept a little later, but some kind of sense of his being an authority among all the other angels. And that was even referenced up here in Daniel chapter 10, one of the chief princes. Michael the archangel, when contending with the devil about the body of Moses, did not dare to bring against him a railing accusation, but he said, "The Lord rebuke thee." And I think what's striking about this is even Michael does not take it upon himself to use authority to rebuke the devil directly. Instead, contending with the devil, he points to the Lord. The Lord will deal with you. And there is in that an implication that there's a limitation on this angel's remit, on his authority, on his power, that he would turn instead and say, the Lord will deal with you. Similarly, up here in Daniel chapter 10, we talked about earlier Gabriel contending with the prince of the kingdom of Persia, so some kind of demonic opponent. And Michael comes and helps him, and they are fighting together now. Well, you get the sense from both of those passages that there is some kind of limitation on their power. They met some kind of opponent that was greater than they, and they had to stop in terms of that. In that battle, they temporarily paused because of the limitation on their power. Now, there is something to say here about some of the power or the ability of angels. And here's just an excerpt from our notes. We ought to be clear that angels are extraordinarily powerful beings with power and capabilities far beyond our own. So we see language in Psalm 8 that mankind was made temporarily a little lower than the angels. I think that is the idea that they are more powerful than we. Angels are great in might and power, 2 Peter 2. And you see illustrations of this when a single angel can roll back the stone at Jesus' grave. A human is going to struggle doing that. Two angels just alone by themselves strike an entire mob with blindness. Or we discover that in Revelation 4, the angels need no rest when they sing praises day and night endlessly. Or we see even Satan's power when he's dealing with Job, that he has the ability to bring together and orchestrate all of these trials at one time. Well, it's extraordinary power. No human could do all of that and pull it off. Angels have also great intellectual powers. The statement in 2 Samuel 14:17 is to say that a person is extremely wise. It says their intellectual abilities are almost like an angel, which probably is hyperbole. It's kind of an intentional overstatement. The point being that to compare someone to an angel is to say that the person is extraordinarily intelligent. So the impression we get across scripture is that as we talk about angels, we're supposed to be amazed, really, at their power. They are much greater than we are, much more powerful than we. And yet, critically, to remember that angels are limited. Angels are not divine. They are not eternal. They are created beings made by God. Now, let's talk about a second question. The second question that I asked here was about the nature of angels. How are angels different from humans? And how could we even kind of describe or imagine the nature of angels? So a few things that we ought to recognize first. There are in scripture different labels that are given of angels. So we read about cherubim, seraphim, living creatures. We read about archangels. Cherubim as a description, we're not actually even sure what it refers to specifically, what that word itself means. But we have a number of passages that talk about cherubim doing something. One of the most memorable of these is the Garden of Eden. After man sinned, then God placed at the entrance of the garden cherubim. By the way, just so you know, cherubim is the plural, the Hebrew way of saying cherub. So a single cherub, or if two or more, cherubim. And you find a similar thing happening. One of the biggest repeated patterns is cherubim on the Ark of the Covenant, over the mercy seat, two angels created from gold, but hammered out, and the picture of them holding up the mercy seat. And so you see this all the way through the tabernacle, even into the veil, there's the picture of cherubim in it. You have a little bit later some description of cherubim. So you see there, this mostly talking about the tabernacle, but you see things like here, he rode upon a cherub and he did fly, poetic language describing the beauty of a cherub and the greatness of a deliverance there. Or if you move further, then you find Hezekiah praying to the Lord, O Lord God of Israel, who dwells between the cherubim, thou alone art God. And just to click through here, I want you to appreciate the number of places that we see this all the way through scripture. It's a lot. Ezekiel 10 is going to describe in more specific form the cherubim. So it's going to be there as above the head of the cherubim, like a sapphire stone. And there's going to be coals of fire between the cherubim standing on the right side of the house. The sound of the cherubim's wings was heard. And you're going to see then cherubim interacting, one cherub stretching forth his hand from between to the fire and so forth. Just a little bit before that, you also have a description here, Ezekiel 9, the glory of God was gone up from the cherub where he was. And we'll return to another passage, Ezekiel 10, that doesn't use the word cherubs, but we find descriptions of angels. Here, Ezekiel 10, 14 gets more specific. You see the face of a cherub, this first face like a cherub, the second face, the face of a man, the third, the face of a lion, the fourth, the face of an eagle. So what's going on here? Some kind of description of wings and some multiple faces and something like that. Okay. Some difficulty even to understand what we're talking about, but definitely some sense of a glorious creature. A second description that we find is seraphim. And in the case of seraphim, we can actually say a little bit more. The word seraph or seraphim, the plural, would be burning ones. So there's the sense here of fire and a kind of a glory that's connected with these angels. And if we're looking at descriptions in Isaiah 6, you see actually quite specific, almost anatomical descriptions. Here are the cherubim, or it's the seraphim, excuse me, each one with six wings. Two wings he covers his face, two wings he covers his feet, with two wings he flies, and one cries to another and saying, "Holy, holy, holy is the whole Lord of hosts, the whole earth is full of his glory." Something that's interesting a bit later, just like with the cherubim in Ezekiel, you discover that the seraphim can come with a live coal in his hand, which he took with the tongs, and he lays it upon Isaiah's mouth. And he interacts with Isaiah, "Lo, this has touched your lips, your iniquity is taken away." So it's something that's, I think, striking about that description is the reality that these creatures are capable of interacting with the world. They're capable of doing things in at least this space, lifting a tong, bringing it, interacting directly with Isaiah. A third category that we find in Scripture is the living creatures. And this is primarily described in Revelation chapter 4. But on our way there, we'll stop here in Ezekiel chapter 1. You have four living creatures. Here's the appearance. Their appearance has the likeness of a man. So that's probably where a lot of our art gets the anthropomorphic kind of framework for an angel. And yet, everyone has four faces, and each one has four wings. They have straight feet. The sole of their feet was like the sole of a calf's foot. Okay. And they sparkled like the color of burnished brass. They had the hands of a man under their wings on the four sides. They four had their faces and their wings. You do sometimes see this in art where the wings also have hands somewhere. Their wings are joined one to another. They turn not when they went. They went everyone straight forward. In likeness of their faces, they four had the face of a man and the face of a lion. On the right side, they had the face of an ox. On the left side, the four had the face of an eagle. These were their faces. And they went up and down. The fire was bright. Out of the fire went forth lightning. The creatures ran and returned as the appearance of lightning. And actually, then the description gets even more surreal after that. I beheld the living creatures, one wheel upon the earth with his four faces. The appearance of the wheels and their work was like unto the color of a barrel, like a glowing gemstone. They four had one likeness. Their appearance and the work was as it were a wheel in the middle of a wheel, like a gyroscope, I suppose. When they went upon their four sides and they turned not when they went. And as for their rings, they were so high that they were dreadful. Their wings were full of eyes round about. The living creatures were lifted up from the earth. The wheels were lifted up. And wherever the spirit went, then the wheels also lifted up. What is going on here? And all of these descriptions are so fantastical as to be surreal. It's hard to even know if you were trying to follow this description and write out a diagram, what you're even looking at. I'll jump down to Revelation, and now Revelation 4 is going to give us a kind of a parallel description. It's a description of the throne room of God, and we're just going to meet here the four living creatures. So in the midst of the throne and round about the throne were four beasts. Beasts sounds, I think, to our English ear, very animal-like. The word really is going to be living creatures. It's just parallel to Ezekiel's language. The four beasts of full of eyes before and behind. The first beast was like a lion, the second beast like a calf, the third beast the face of a man, the fourth beast like a flying eagle. So you've got quite a bit of parallelism, the language of living creatures, the reference to full of eyes and the four faces. But there's some interesting things going on here. Because actually, the four faces here are a little different than the four faces in Ezekiel. You can compare the two passages, and there are some differences. What's more, we looked at Ezekiel 1 that talked about living creatures. We looked at Ezekiel 10 that used the language of cherubim. But the descriptions overlap. It kind of sounds like maybe they're the same creature. And what's more, if you go to the Isaiah passage, the seraphim passage, you can find some kind of parallels or possibilities overlapping between Isaiah and Ezekiel. So we end up with this whole question where what we thought maybe was, okay, here are three different categories or types or species of angels. We end up in this place where it doesn't sound like it. It kind of, they're all overlapping in different ways. And what's going on here? And even though they're overlapping in some ways, they're also different in other ways. And we're not even sure what to say. Well, here's a clue. Matthew 22, verse 30. This is Jesus talking about marriage and the nature of the resurrection. And the question goes, in the resurrection, will there continue to be marriage? Or will people continue to be related to someone or something like that? And Jesus' answer to them is, no, no, you're very mixed up. In the resurrection, they neither marry nor are given in marriage, but they are as the angels of God in heaven. And that's about as far as it goes. It's not a super clear statement. The passage doesn't give us a whole lot more information beyond that. But I think this is fair enough to say that the comparison made to angels is to tell us here, angels are not like us. They are not a species like we are. They are not a race of creatures. As in, you know, God makes two giraffes, and then those giraffes have baby giraffes, and those babies have babies and babies. And so you end up with all kinds of giraffes. Or people, and people reproduce, and you have more people and more, and eventually, okay, you have lots of people. But those people basically are made or reproduced in the image or according to the kind of their parents. Well, in the case of angels, they don't reproduce. And we're not then talking about a species. We're not then talking about a chain, a race, a group of people that reproduce and have more of their own kind. We're talking about something entirely different here. And I think this is probably the way we ought to process with angels. Imagine that as God creates the world, he creates an elephant, he creates a giraffe, he creates a zebra, he creates a lizard. Okay, he creates the different species. And in our case on planet Earth, as we just said, these creatures go on to reproduce. But what if God just made one? He just made one lizard. And he said, that's beautiful. And that's it. The lizard's not going to reproduce. The lizard's not going to make more after its kind. You're not going to end up with millions of lizards. He made a single lizard. That's the lizard. And I think that's probably the way we ought to think about angels. That it's not that God makes a race, and therefore we have a group of seraphim over here, and we have a group of cherubim over here, we have a group of living creatures over here. But he just makes, we don't know exactly how many, but thousands at least of these angels. And everyone is an individual creation. Everyone is, as far as we know, it would appear unique. Each one of them by themselves. And then he moves on and he makes another one. Our God is so creative that he would not run out of ideas. And significantly then, that helps us make sense of why we have these different distinctions or these different words, cherubim, seraphim, living creatures, not so much to give us categories or species of angels, as much as to give us just different descriptions of angels. They're burning ones. They are like the cherubim, the different descriptions that we have. They are living creatures and just different ways of saying who and what they are. I want to move to a separate and related question. I was asking here, are angels like us? Or how are angels similar or different to us? And there is another pattern here of talking about angels specifically as spirits. Spirits without bodies, but spirits. So here's a set of passages that give that kind of language for us. And there are others we could talk about, but we'll work with these. Luke 20, verse 36, he's talking about the resurrection. People who die cannot die anymore. They are equal unto the angels, being children of the resurrection. Okay, so the idea here goes that an angel then is a being that cannot die. You don't have a physical body that's going to die. Luke 24, 39, this is Jesus after his resurrection. Behold my hands and my feet, it is I myself, handle me and see. A spirit does not have flesh and bones as you see me have. Okay, so just the concept I'm going for here, Jesus, when he was glorified, is not like an angel. That's not my point. Jesus did not become an angel. Jesus has never been, nor will ever be an angel. Jesus' point actually here is to say that he's not like that, that he has a physical body. He says, I have hands and feet. He's resurrected now, he's glorified. I have hands and feet. A spirit does not have flesh and bones as you see me have. And the concept here would be to say, angels are spirits, and that means they don't have flesh and bones. And you see that finally in the passage that we talked about earlier, Hebrews 1:14, angels are ministering spirits sent forth to minister. So what is an angel? An angel is a spirit without a body. That simple. And at a later point, we will talk about what are spirits, just to kind of get our ideas in order here. But I will say this on our way there, just to talk about spirits, because I've never seen a spirit. I have a tendency, wrongly, to think something like spirits are less real than physical bodies. And somehow spirits are kind of ghosty, smoky, hazy things. You can't really say over there or here. It's just sort of an idea or something like that. I just like to point out that we have passages that talk about spirits. Here's Daniel chapter 9. And he says, while I was speaking, in prayer, the man Gabriel, whom I had seen at the vision at the beginning, came swiftly and he touched me. Okay, one comment here is the spirit is capable of touching Daniel. And I think that fits with what we saw like in Isaiah and Ezekiel, a spirit who picks up a coal. I mean, the spirit is able to interact with physical stuff, apparently. The spirit is able to touch Daniel. But I'd like to point out here that Daniel notices and he says, the man Gabriel, whom I had seen in the vision at the beginning. What does he mean? It's pointing back to chapter 8, where Daniel saw Gabriel before, a man's voice saying, Gabriel, make this man to understand the vision. Daniel had seen Gabriel. Now in chapter 9, Daniel sees Gabriel again, and there is no reference here that Gabriel said, hi, I'm Gabriel, the one before. It's just that Daniel sees the man that he saw before, and he says, aha, Gabriel. And a point I'd like to make here that I think is really interesting about those references together is that we get the sense that angels are recognizable. In other words, to have seen an angel and to recognize the angel, you might come back later again and say, aha, that was the same angel I saw before. Very same one, I recognize the individual. So it's worth acknowledging and recognizing that while angels are spirits, we should not be thinking of them as just formless, shapeless spirits that have no actual form that can be recognized. You could see an angel and recognize that's Gabriel, not Michael. They're different. This angel is different than the other angel. An additional question that we talked about, a third question, is how many angels are there? And this is a question that's impossible to exactly settle, but I will show you here just what I think helpfully summarizes some of the information. This is, again, lifted right out of your notes, but some biblical information. We read of 10,000s of holy ones, or we read of twice 10,000, thousands upon thousands. If that's thousands multiplied by 1,000, then we're talking about millions. And that would fit with Daniel 7:10, 10,000 times 10,000. So now we're up into the 100 million kind of range. Jesus reminds Peter that Peter can appeal to the Father and he will send at once to me more than 12 legions of angels. Based on what a legion is and just multiplying, that's about 36,000. John saw many angels numbering myriads of myriads and thousands of thousands. Again, we're up into the millions now. So all of this is to say that we have no specific number. We do know there are a lot. And the rest of the story that's so interesting is, even if we're talking about millions, we're actually talking about only a part. We're talking about only 2/3 out of the total angelic creatures that God made. I won't go down this track right now, but you remember, I hope, that later on we discover in Revelation that 1/3 of the angelic host fell together with Satan. So when we're talking about millions of angels, there's actually an additional 1/3. That's only 2/3. So, you know, I don't know, what would we say? At least another 500,000 that are demons. And just to give us a sense, I think the best way to understand this would just be to say there's lots, lots and lots, more than you can possibly imagine. Another kind of clue to the sense of the number of angels, or a way to kind of appreciate just the immensity of this throng, is that we have the language of archangels. And here, two passages that primarily talk about this, though there are other words in other places that use the same language. 1 Thessalonians 4:16, the Lord will descend with the voice of an archangel. That's not Jesus' voice, but the voice of the archangel coming together with him. You also have June 9, when the archangel Michael. An archangel is a Greek way of expressing the chief angel. Okay, so arch is the top, the one who's above all the others. You have also in Daniel the reference to Michael as one of the chief princes. So what's happening with that? I think the idea goes, we're getting the sense that even within the angelic throng, there is organization. There are ranks. There are angels who are kind of in charge of other angels, or angels who have authority with other angels. A fourth question I want to ask is, what do angels do? Can we find in Scripture a pattern of an angel's behavior, or what an angel's role would be? And for foundation, or for starters, it's important that we recognize angels as servants. In other words, if our imagination with angels goes that they're kind of, back to our diagram, closer to God than they are to humans, and therefore they are a semi-divine kind of status. There's God, and then there's, you know, just underneath him, angels, and they're kind of like a suborder beneath God. We missed it completely. Angels are simply servants. Multiple passages that confirm that. One we've already seen, Hebrews 1:14. They are ministering or serving spirits sent out to serve for your sake as a Christian, as a human. We have a very interesting pattern in Revelation. So twice this happens, and we could talk about later the significance of it, because there's very important significance for our understanding of Christ. John sees an angel. He fell down at his feet to worship the angel. And the angel responds right away, you must not do that. You should worship God. Okay, an important point here is that God is the only one worthy of worship. Why? Because I'm just a fellow servant with you and your brothers. How does the angel view his relationship to John? There is no sense here of, oh, you mere human, I am over you and I will control you. There's very much the sense of worship God, and I am parallel to you in the sense that I am your fellow brother, your fellow servant. And it happens again in Revelation 22:8. John, again, confused. He fell down to worship at the feet of the angel. And the angel said, again, you must not do that. I am a fellow servant with you and your brothers. Worship God. So what's going on here? To say here with angels, what did they do? For starters, they are merely servants. They merely serve God. And they have a role then of faithfully carrying out his will, which takes me into two clear statements that we have in Scripture about that role or what that looks like. One is that angels function as messengers. Okay, the most famous example of these is that an angel appears to Mary and gives her the good news of the Savior's birth. You find this actually in Luke chapter 1, the angel speaking to Zechariah and announcing the good news to Zechariah. Then you find even more clearly stated, because here now we have a name, Luke chapter 1, still verse 26, the angel Gabriel was sent from God, and the angel brought the message, greetings, O favored one, the Lord is with you. And the angel then carries out the message. But if you keep on going with angels as messengers, you find angels delivering messages a lot. You find angels delivering messages to Daniel. You find angels speaking or interacting with people all across the Old Testament, even an angel being part of delivering a message through dreams at times. So the concept of an angel as a message bearer or a person who announces something is a major pattern across scripture. And to support that, what's interesting is that the word angel itself actually means messenger. That's the meaning of the word. If you go back and you want to know what angel means, the word means messenger. But it's not just as messengers that angels fulfill their role. There is a second pattern, and the second pattern here is that angels fulfill the role of worshiping. So I'll show you two passages that do this. Isaiah chapter 6, we've already seen before. The angels are flying and they cry out one to another, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory." A very strong emphasis here to say, what do angels do? They worship God. Similarly, Revelation chapter 4, and again, we see the picture of the angels. You see the before the throne, the four living creatures, and the first beast like a lion, second beast like a calf, third beast a man, the fourth beast like a flying eagle. So it's the pattern that we've already seen with the four living creatures and their four faces. What do? They rest not day and night saying, "Holy, holy, holy, Lord God Almighty, which was and is to come." Part of what's so interesting here is that Isaiah referred to these as seraphim. Now they're described as living creatures. But the parallel between the words that they say and the wings and some of these other details are strong parallels across. They give glory and honor and thanks to him that sits on the throne who lives forever and ever. And together with the 24 elders, they fall before him, they worship him. And they cry out saying, "You are worthy to receive glory and honor and power. You have created all things for your pleasure. They were created." So the pattern that we get with angels, they are created beings. They're merely fellow servants for two primary purposes we find emphasized in scripture, for the purpose of carrying messages and for the purpose of worshiping God. I want to return, however, to one of the opening questions I asked you. One of my opening questions was, if I have this kind of chart, God and man, and I'm trying to figure out where to place angels, where would I place angels on this chart? You remember our conclusion, angels are created beings. Therefore, they really go appropriately together with mankind as another created being. But there's a little more detail that's kind of interesting. And I want you to notice how exactly I set up the chart. I did set it up and intentionally with angels slightly above humans. I mean, it's a chart. So what is the sense of being slightly above, or what does that even mean? I don't know. But this was not an accident. I did not set them in parallel. And I want to be careful and not say that angels are, you know, more godlike. They're nothing like God in the sense that they're created beings. In fact, angels are not even made in the image of God as humans are. So there's a fundamental difference. You are made in God's image, angels are not. But at least for a time, scripture describes angels and the sense of their glory slightly above our own. Now, how do I support that? Because rather than just making an assertion, let's make sure we actually can support the idea. And the thing that's interesting here is that we find the pattern, particularly this coming from Psalm 8, that there's for a little while an exaltation of, or let's say, humanity below angels. So here, let's look at the passage, the critical passage here, Psalm 8. And the question goes, what is man that thou art mindful of him, or the son of man that thou visitest him? His point here is really at the same time, both to ask the humility of man, why is man so low? And in some ways, the dignity of man. Why is man exalted, made in the image of God? Why does God care about humanity? On the one hand, you made him a little lower than the angels. And the point of this is to say, according to my diagram and what we've talked about, just a little lower than the angels for a time, and yet crowned with glory and honor. That concept is the concept of the image of God in man. I know that because verse 6, you made man to have dominion over the works of your hands. You put all things under his feet. So critically, we have to maintain, we should know, and you should remember that angels are not made in the image of God as people are. But also the point just made here, that for a time, humanity is a little lower than angels. What does that mean? Well, I think the concept goes that in the present, I am weaker than an angel in a lot of ways, actually. I need rest. I run out of strength. What we saw earlier, they rest not day or night, but they continually praise God. I can't do that. I don't have the same physical power moving a stone or the intellectual power, or even the ability of an angel to just travel across immense distances. And most significantly, I sin. I'm going to die. None of that happens to an angel. So there is very much the sense that I am at this point lower than the angels. Something that's interesting. Hebrews chapter 2 picks up Psalm 8, it quotes it, and now extends the language just a little bit more. So he begins quoting language we just read, what is man that you are mindful of him, or the son of man that thou visitest him. And then you find this, thou madest him a little lower than the angels. And he continues on quoting the rest of the passage. The interesting thing is verse 9, quoting this now, we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, we see him crowned with glory and honor, that by the grace of God, he should taste death for everyone. And this is where the plot actually thickens. This is where the question actually becomes even more complex, but also beautiful. To recognize that we are made a little lower than the angels, but that is in fact a kind of a temporary reality. Here's an excerpt from your notes just to process some of these ideas. This condition we discover is just for a little while, according to Hebrews 2:7. In Revelation, meaning through the words that God has revealed, we have received things into which angels long to look. Do you realize the Bible that you hold and the truth God has given you is so beautiful that an angel is in awe at some of the things we're studying in this class? An angel, even though they see the glory of God and his greatness there and his presence, there is the sense that they are very curious to know about Bible doctrines and systematic theology because of the beautiful truths that God has revealed to us. We discover that God subjected the created world to people and not to angels. We discover that Jesus Christ came not to help angels, but the offspring of Abraham. We discover that angels are only our fellow servants. They follow and glorify the same Lord. And in the end, 1 Corinthians 6:3, Paul says, do you not know that we will judge angels? I don't think the idea here is that we'll sit there and randomly decide, okay, you're going to suffer this and you're going to receive this. I think the idea is that what we discover in Revelation as well, believers have a role in affirming, confirming the judgment that God gives. But it's the recognition that at the end of time, as demons face their judgment for what they've done, do you realize human beings have a place in some of that judgment? You have a rich heritage, the dignity of being a human being. And so if I was going to return back to my original chart, I started out by putting angels slightly above us, but just recognize the richness and the awe of the gospel. It is quite fair and reasonable to say that glorified together with Christ, we are exalted and we will rule and reign in a role that is mind-blowingly beautiful. Jesus Christ became flesh and is truly human. What higher dignity is there than that? And we humans reigning together with Christ, we'll judge angels. We will have the extraordinary dignity made in the image of God, sharing in the glory that Christ won through his victory on Calvary and his resurrection. When we talk then about angels and how they relate to humans, we really have to come to that conclusion, the richness and the beauty of salvation. And I'm going to end then with a final passage that I think summarizes much of this information and does so in a beautiful way. We're looking at Luke chapter 2. It's the announcement of the angels to the shepherds about the coming of the Messiah. This is a familiar passage. It gets recited in every Christmas program. I just want you to notice the role of angels within the story. So our focus generally in Christmas programs and such is on the shepherds and on the Christ child. And that's probably where our focus ought to be. But just to process for a second, based on everything we've discussed together today, that angels are also part of this miracle that's happening here. Or specifically, we should say, angels are in awe. Angels are also worshiping. Okay, so let's notice a couple of patterns here to begin with. Right at the front, you have the note that it's an angel that comes to bring them the message. A comment here in passing, when we read the angel of the Lord, then we should always be thinking this is an appearance of Jesus Christ. In this case, what we're talking about, however, is an angel of the Lord. This is not the angel of the Lord. It's not Christ. And we know this because Christ is born. But an angel, someone like Michael, Gabriel, one of the angels that we've been talking about in this entire chapter, came. We also find a multitude of the angels around them, and an entire multitude of the heavenly hosts together, and then the angels depart. Okay, so it should be fairly clear then that what's happening here is the presence of the angels announcing this news to the shepherds. One of the things I think that happens here that we maybe misunderstand is we imagine the glory of the angels shining. But I think we should notice an interesting detail here. It's the glory of the Lord that's shining. And it's the glory of the Lord shining round about them. And my understanding of this is not the glory of the Lord shining round about the angels. It's the glory of the Lord shining around the shepherds. So the detail that we had just a moment ago about shepherds watching by night, you're supposed to imagine a dark scene, and then suddenly the scene just explodes in glory. It's the glory of God. And it's the glory of God shining even around the shepherds so that the shepherds are surrounded by this glory. The angels bring the good tidings of great joy, and they declare, "You will find this baby lying in a manger." And when you discover this language here, suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly hosts. There is information here to say to us that basically the angels are more or less surrounding the shepherds. So what we often imagine is the shepherds kind of as spectators, they're looking up into the sky and the angels are a safe distance away. I don't think that's the visual imagery we ought to have. There really is the concept of the angels surrounding the shepherds. I would like you to imagine the shepherds on the ground, the glory of the Lord around and surrounding the shepherds, and suddenly just a circle of angels surrounding the shepherds. The glory of God poured out, and the shepherds in total and complete awe. And what the angels declare is now the glory of God. Glory to God in the highest. On earth, peace, goodwill toward men, tidings of great joy. And I think the significance of this is to say that as the angels have declared this information to the shepherds, rather than us imagining that the angels are sort of dispassionately just kind of bearing a message, okay, here's a thing or two to say, this news, okay, I've related my message, I'll go home now. I think on the contrary, what I'm supposed to appreciate here is the marvel of the angels themselves hearing what God has declared. And the angels coming, like 1 Peter describes, things into which angels long to look. The angels come to announce the glory of this event, and the angels themselves are in awe. What are the angels doing? They're worshiping. It's not merely just a recitation of some information. I said my part, now I go. But I said angels are messengers and they are worshipers. Can you imagine an angel hearing God's intentions for the Messiah? And the angel that has been there for thousands of years, that has watched all of these humans fail and sin and die and the horror of sin, they've watched the flood, they've watched the Babylonian conquest, they've watched murder and pillaging, they've watched all the destruction and sorrow on planet Earth. And then God declares to this angel, I have intentions, the Messiah, salvation will come. And the angel now in awe. And the angel now sent to declare the message. And the angel comes down and he declares to the shepherds, here's the news. Can you believe it? And the declaration of the angel is at the same time worship, because the angel himself is astounded. But I think there's more. Look carefully through the picture, the glory of God, the angels there present and worshiping together. And language even like glory to God in the highest, in the realm above, and on earth, peace, goodwill. What happened there? And I think for a moment, there was the picture of the glory of God, or even the throne room of God, part of the picture of what goes on all the time in God's presence in heaven. And for a brief moment, that was brought down, and angels and people fellowshipped and shared together for a few moments in the marvel and the miracle of the incarnation, and the glory of God for that moment, together with people there, angels, people, worshiping in awe in the presence of the glory of God. I think that is a picture of just how wonderful the good news is. Because now, in the Messiah and in the incarnation, not only do we have the presence of the glory of God, but we have actually God with us. The Messiah has come. And the beauty of that is the hope that the Messiah will bring about life for all who are pleasing in God's sight, all who put their trust in him. And someday, fast forwarding to Revelation, you will have angels and people together, Revelation chapter 4, worshiping God in his presence. You're going to stand next to an angel someday. And what are you going to cry out for all eternity? Glory, glory in the highest. There's going to be one really interesting difference, and that is that you have experienced what it is to have betrayed God, and then to have been forgiven, and then to have been redeemed. You have experienced salvation. You have experienced the gospel. And for all eternity, you get to declare the praise together with the angels, but in a way that is unique to us as humans, being able to praise God for his glorious grace. Understanding the theology of angels, understanding the richness of what this means, ought to drive us back to this core. Glory to God in the highest. Look at the good, the peace and the joy and the goodwill that he has brought to all who trust in the Messiah and who are pleasing in his sight. Glory to God in the highest. And get ready for the day when, together with the angels, you will praise him forever.